Okay, so once again, good morning. Okay, we'll start it. Okay, so in last lecture, we can study the basic concept of image transform. What is the need of image transform? Why we can use the image transform? Okay, so why we can consider the two-dimensional plane? Okay, so as we represent the images, yeah, as we consider the various types of images, so if we capture the images by using various cameras, yeah, by using various digital devices, we need to convert the three-dimensional world into the two-dimensional world. Wait 1 minute. हाँ हेलो, द प्रेजेंटेशन इज विजिबल।
ओ
ओके ओके, सो इन लास्ट लेक्चर वी कैन डिस्कस वेरियस टाइप्स ऑफ ट्रांसफॉर्म्स। व्हाट इज द नीड ऑफ ट्रांसफॉर्म, हाउ वी कैन कन्वर्ट द वन डोमेन इनटू द अनदर डोमेन। ओके, सो बाय यूजिंग द वेरियस टाइप्स ऑफ इमेज ट्रांसफॉर्म वी कैन स्टडी we can convert the various types of spatial domain information into the frequency domain information. So basically, we have to study the four types of transforms in our second unit. So in image processing, there are number of transforms, so that can be used in various applications. So out of that, we have to study the four basic transform. That is a Fourier transform, cosine transform, then wavelet transform, and KL transform. So in last lecture, we can discuss the Fourier transform, how to represent the Fourier transform, how we can consider the inverse Fourier transform, we can consider the its block diagram, how we can convert the G plane into the H plane, right? So by using inverse Fourier transform, again we can remodify the original data, and we can also discuss the various properties regarding to the Fourier transform. So the basic of Fourier transform can be used. Okay, so we can also discuss the representation of Fourier transform. Okay, so if we apply the Fourier transform on an image, how the output of image will be look like? So in order to represent the Fourier transform, we have to consider the two planes. That is X plane and Y plane, and whatever the intensity values that are represented on a third axis. Okay. Okay. So as we study, there are various limitation of discrete Fourier transform. That is, it might be our it. Various noises can be added in the output image. So as we consider the representation of Fourier transform, so there are two planes, one is X and another is a Y. So whatever the amplitude values or what are the intensity values that are changes point to point, it might be a various types of noises, right? So due to that, the various ringing effect can be observed in a Fourier transform. Now, what is a ringing effect? Right, so the various types of noises, various types of discontinuities, so that can be occurred in the output of Fourier transform image. So when we convert the spatial domain into the frequency domain, yeah, when we convert the information from one domain to the another domain, so as we know, the output of Fourier transform might be in the form of matrices. So always we can represent the image into the matrix format. So it having n number of rows and n number of columns. So as we convert the information from one domain to the another domain, so at that time, so there is a possibility to change the size of kernels. So now the kernels means the small matrix. So it may be a 2x2, 4x4, 8x8, or 16x16. So in order to convert the information from one domain to the another domain by using the Fourier transform, so there is a possibility to change the dimension of matrices. Yeah, we can call it as the various size of kernels may be different. Okay, so also in case of storage capacity, so as we study the image compression techniques, okay, so by using image compression technique we can reduce the size of image. But if we apply this type of Fourier transform, so in order to store the image also it can require higher memory as compared to another transforms. So due to these problems we can use the discrete Fourier transform. Okay, so basically there are two objective in order to use the discrete Fourier transform. The first one is that we have to reduce the storage capability to store the various types of images. Okay, so if we apply the Fourier transform on an image, then to store that particular image we require a higher memory. Okay, everyone understood it? Samajhtega? Thode image mein rehte hain. Okay, so as our second unit is a total mathematical part, it consists of a Fourier transform and its mathematical representation. So might be it is difficult to understand it. Okay, so once we study the various types of properties and how basically we can use these type of transforms, so that will be better to understand it. So basic thing to study these four type of transform is that how we can convert the information from one domain into the another domain and how we can represent by this transform by using a mathematical equations. Okay, so when we study the application of these transforms in a practical case, so at that time our concept should be more clear. Okay, so in this case, by explaining theoretically might be you are not able to understand the concepts. So as we studied in the first unit, so the first unit is a total theoretical unit, so there is a not lot of mathematical part. Okay, so it consists of various fundamental things, but the second unit consists of the mathematical part. Okay, so just try to understand how we can represent these type of transforms. What is the basic use of these transforms? Okay, have you found out any difficulty to understood it? Yes. थोड़ा अवगड़ वाटते का सेकंड यूनिट. यस एनीवन?
नहीं सर.
ओके, सो जस्ट ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड इट. इट कंसिस्ट ऑफ टोटल मैथमेटिकल पार्ट. ओके ओके, सो द फर्स्ट ट्रांसफॉर्म इज दैट द फोरियर ट्रांसफॉर्म. सो व्हाइल यूजिंग फोरियर ट्रांसफॉर्म we have a one disadvantage, that is the memory size, yeah, the storage capacity will be require more as compared to another transform. So as our aim is we have to reduce the storing capacity. So if the image having a higher size, so it might be a 50 MB, 100 MB, so it require, so it can consume our a lot of memory. So in order to reduce the memory size and also in order to convert the spatial domain information into the frequency domain information, that is we have to represent the image in a matrix format. Okay, so in order to achieve this objective we have to use the discrete cosine transform. So normally this discrete cosine transform can be used in a image compression. Okay, so there are different types of images are there. So can you tell me the different types of image formats? So in which format we can generally store the images? Konte इमेज फॉर्मेट तुम्हाला माहिती आहेत. येस ओके. व्हाट आर द डिफरंट फॉर्मेट्स ऑफ इमेजेस? येस एंड विच फॉर्मेट वी कैन जनरली यूज? डू हैव एनी आइडिया?
जेपीजी और पीएनजी.
ओके वेरी गुड. सो देर आर वेरियस टाइप्स ऑफ फॉर्मैट्स, दैट इज अ जेपीजी फॉर्मैट एंड पीएनजी फॉर्मैट, पीएमपी फॉर्मैट, राइट, टीआईएफएफ फॉर्मैट. सो देर आर डिफरेंट फॉर्मैट्स ऑफ द इमेजेस. सो आउट ऑफ दैट फॉर्मैट जनरली व्हाई वी कैन यूज दिस ओनली द जेपीजी फॉर्मैट? डू यू हैव एनी आइडिया? So normally, if we observe the properties, if we see the properties of image, so all the most of the images are in JPG format. So can you have any reason, any idea why we can use only JPG image? Yes, who is Spider-Man? So don't put such type of comment in a chat box. So it's a lecture time. Who is the Spider-Man? Astro lecture madhe chalnar nahi. Okay. Je kone asal te, keep in mind. Okay. So the basic idea is to use that JPG image. Is that so? In order to store the image, in order to store the memory, so JPG image can require the less memory as compared to another image format. So if we save the image in PDF, if we save the image in PNG, if we save the image in BMP format or the TIFF format, so that format can require higher memory size. Okay, so if we compare the various image formats and if we observe the its memory size, so you can take a one image and that one image we can store in a different formats. Okay, so I'll also show you in a practical time also how we can save the image in a different formats and how we can judge the quality as well as its storing capacity. So the JPG image can require the less size to store the data. It can require minimum memory. So that's why in most of time, in most of applications, instead of other formats, the JPG image can be used. So the discrete cosine transform can be used generally in a JPG image compression. Okay, so most of the time we can deal with the JPG images. So again, if we reduce the size of JPG image, in that case we can use the discrete cosine transform. Okay, so by using discrete cosine transform we can reduce the size of JPG image. So here it is a mathematical representation of discrete cosine transform. So as we know, if we convert the information from one domain into the another domain, so the output of any transforms might be in a matrix format. Okay, so that matrix is called as a kernels. So basically the kernels can be represented with a k, as symbol as a k. There are n number of kernels can be presented in the output of discrete cosine transform. Okay, so whatever the kernels, so that kernels can be represented by this mathematical equation. So as we observed here, the k1, k2, right? So it is a mathematical representation of different kernels. So basically, what is a kernel? So the kernel means a small piece of matrices. So if we consider the matrix, we are having two rows and two columns, then the size would be 2 by 2. So that is called as a kernel. Okay, so these kernels are helpful to reduce the image size, and it can helpful to reduce the memory size to store the images. So basically, these kernels are helpful to reduce the size of images. So by using these mathematical formulae, we can represent the discrete cosine transform. Okay. So similarly, as in a Fourier transform, to again bring back the original image, also we can apply the inverse discrete cosine transform. Okay, so as we apply the discrete cosine transform, the one information can be converted into the another domain. But if we have to bring back this same information, if we have to bring back the original content of the image, then we can apply the inverse discrete cosine transforms. So by using inverse cosine transform, we can bring back the information into the original form. Okay, so as we know, there are different size of kernels, so that kernels can be used to represent the inverse discrete cosine transform. So as it is a cosine transform, so that's why we can use a cos term. Okay, so here why we can use this formula, why can use only two summations. Okay, so as we have two domains, right, so we can represent some part on a x axis and some part on a y axis. So whatever the information on x axis, so that we can represent by a one summation, and that can be ranges from 0 to n minus 1. So why we can use n minus 1 and y is equal to 0 up to m minus 1. So why? Because if we consider any dimension of image, so if we consider the dimension of image at 256, then the pixel value nothing but 0 to 255, right? So in due to this, so always we can represent the images from the origin. So if the dimension is 256, then we can consider from 0 to 255. So that's why we can consider m minus 1 and n minus 1. Okay, so these two summations are considered because we have a two spatial coordinates. One is a x and another is a y. Okay, so similar to this, so same figure we can use here. So same the input image can be used, so that used in a Fourier transform. So here, instead of Fourier transform, we can apply the discrete cosine transform. So as we compare the output of this, so you can get you can easily get the idea how the output will be different from the discrete Fourier transform. Okay, so I will show the output of Fourier transform. Okay, so here is the output of Fourier transform. So it having a discontinuous change in intensity, so we can represent in x axis and y axis, and the third axis indicates the amplitude or intensity. So here we can observe there is a change in intensity. There is an intensity is not constant and not in a one plane. So at every interval, at every time, the intensity might be a high, intensity might be a low, right? So if we observe the output of cosine transform, so here if we observe the output of cosine transform, so observe the x plane, y plane, and what are the information on a third plane. So all the amplitude values are a constant in a one plane. Have you observed the change? Yes. Have you got the two outputs? Have you compared the two outputs of transform? Yes. Have you got the idea how we can keep the amplitude, how we can keep the intensity values constant? So due to this, we can use this discrete cosine transform for the image compression techniques. Have you clear it?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay, so the basic aim of discrete cosine transform is that it can be used to compress the size of images. Okay, so there is a one more transform that is called as a KL transform. So this transform is very important according to your exam point of view. Okay, so we can use the first two transforms Okay, so if we have to reduce the dimensions of the image, so it might be an x orientation, a y orientation, so we can use the KL transform. Okay, so there are two names for this KL transform. So the KL transform, also known as principal component analysis, and the KL transforms, also known as Hotelling transform. Okay, so these are the two names of the KL transform. So it might be a Hotelling transform or the principal component analysis. So why we can call it as a principal component analysis? So the basic aim of KL transform is that it can be used for a dimension reduction. We sort out the x dimension, y dimension, or it may be a z dimension. So if we have to reduce the dimension of images, then we have to use the KL transform. So as we know, the x axis, y axis, and z axis, these are the three basic axis of the images. So it might be in a three dimension. So we have to represent the three dimension information into the two dimensions. So these are the three basic axis. So that three basic axis is called as a principal component analysis. So that's why the KL transform is known as principal component analysis. The basic aim of this transform is that it can be used for dimension reduction. Okay, so the cosine transform can be used to reduce the size of images in case of a storing capacity, but the KL transforms are used to reduce the dimensions of the images. So there are different dimensions of the images, so that dimension can be reduced by the KL transform. Okay, so in order to reduce the dimension of the images, we have to consider the centroid point of the image. Means if we consider the image by using a n number of rows and n number of columns. Okay, so if we consider the 3x3 image, so it consists of 3 rows and 3 columns, right? So out of these 3 rows and 3 columns, we have a total 9 element. Okay, so we can easily find out a centroid. But if the image dimension is 2 more, right? So if the image dimension is 1024 by 1024, then in that case we are not able to identify the centroid point. So if the image is 3x3 size, then we can easily identify the center of that image. Yeah, we can easily identify the centroid point. But the image dimension is more, the image resolution is more. So consider the example is image resolution is 1024 by 1024. So in that case, we are not able to identify the centroid point. So to identify this centroid point, we can use the KL transform, and this is the mathematical representation of KL transform. So by using the image consists of, yes, any doubt? Okay, so if the image consists of more pixels, more rows, more columns, so how we can detect the centroid? So by using these formulas C1, C2, C3, and C4, we can easily detect the centroid of the images. Okay, so basic aim of KL transform is that, so always remembering, the KL transform can be used to reduce the dimension of the image, but it having various limitations. Okay, so if the image size is 2 more, right, so it might be a 2000 by 2000, it may be a 4000 by 4000. So in that case, for that case, we can consider the increasing computational capacity. Means if the image size is more, so in that case we are not able to identify the various centroid point of the images. So as the dimension increases, so it is difficult to identify the centroid points. Okay, so for that purpose, the KL transform can be phased down. Means as we increase the size of image, in first case the size of image is 2x2, so as we increase it 4x4, 8x8, 1000 by 1000, 2000 by 2000, राइट म्हणजे काय होतंय, एज वी इन्क्रीज द डायमेन्शन्स देन इट इज डिफिकल्ट टू आयडेंटिफाय द सेंट्रॉइड, राइट. सो फॉर दॅट द के एल ट्रान्सफॉर्म्स कॅन बी फेज डाऊन. बट नाव फेअर द के एल ट्रान्सफॉर्म्स कॅन बी युज वॉट द ऍप्लिकेशन्स ऑफ के एल ट्रान्सफॉर्म. सो द बेसिक ऍप्लिकेशन ऑफ के एल ट्रान्सफॉर्म इज दॅट वेन वी स्कॅन द फेरियस टाइप्स ऑफ नोट्स. ओके, सो एज वी स्कॅन द फेरियस टाइप्स ऑफ नोट्स, राईट. सो इफ वी इफ द हँड रायटिंग इज नॉट विजिबल प्रॉपरली, सो वी कॅन चेंज द डायरेक्शन ऑफ हँड रायटिंग. सो इट फ्रॉम इट माइट बी फ्रॉम लेफ्ट साइड टू राईट साइड. सो ऑब्झर्व द स्लाइड, सो इट आर द कंटेंट्स ऑफ द स्कॅन नोट्स. ओके, सो इफ यू हॅव टू चेंज द डायरेक्शन ऑफ द कंटेंट, सो टू द लेफ्ट साइड, टू द राईट साइड, राईट. सो वी कॅन चेंज द डायरेक्शन ऑफ हँड रिटन कंटेंट्स फ्रॉम द स्कॅनर्स, राईट. सो इन दॅट ऍप्लिकेशन वी कॅन यूज अ के एल ट्रान्सफॉर्म. सो एज वी ऑब्झर्व इन वर्ड्स, सो देर आर डिफरंट फॉर्मॅट्स, टाइम रोमन, इटालिक, राईट. सो बाय युझिंग दिस वी कॅन चेंज द ओरिएंटेशन, या वी कॅन चेंज द डायरेक्शन ऑफ वर्ड्स, या डायरेक्शन ऑफ कंटेंट्स, राईट. सो सिमिलरली इन केस ऑफ स्कॅनर्स, या इन केस ऑफ स्कॅन नोट्स, सो इफ हॅव टू चेंज द डायरेक्शन ऑफ दीज वर्ड्स देन वी कॅन यूज द के एल ट्रान्सफॉर्म. ओके, सो ऑल्सो द के एल ट्रान्सफॉर्म कॅन बी युज्ड इन ऑब्जेक्ट रिकग्निशन, इन अ पॅटर्न रिकग्निशन. सो एज वी स्टडी द ऍप्लिकेशन ऑफ इमेज प्रोसेसिंग इन ऑब्जेक्ट डिटेक्शन या ऑब्जेक्ट रिकग्निशन. सो इफ द वन इमेज कन्सिस्ट ऑफ नंबर ऑफ ऑब्जेक्ट्स एंड वी हॅव टू आयडेंटिफाय अ सिंगल ऑब्जेक्ट फ्रॉम दॅट इमेज, सो इन दॅट केस द के एल ट्रान्सफॉर्म कॅन बी युज्ड. ओके, द बेसिक डिसअडवांटेज ऑफ के एल ट्रान्सफॉर्म इज दॅट as the dimension of images can be increased, as the resolution can be increased, then it is difficult to identify the centroid point. So in order to reduce that disadvantages, we can use a discrete wavelet transform. Okay, so the KL transform and the discrete wavelet transform are related to each other, and the first two transform, that is a Fourier transform and cosine transform, are related to each other. Okay, so the basic disadvantage of Fourier transform is that it can require the more memory size to store the images. So that disadvantage can be removed by cosine transform. So the cosine transform can reduce the size of images. Okay, so the KL transform having a disadvantage is that as the size of image can be increased, so it is difficult to identify the centroid points. So in order to remove this, we can use the discrete wavelet transform. So how we can reduce the that disadvantages? So as the dimension of image increases, as the resolution of image increases, suppose we have two images, so one having a size 256 by 256 and another having a size 1024 by 1024. So in that case, we can split the images into the smaller units by using discrete wavelet transform. म्हणजे काय, सो एज वी स्टडी द सेगमेंटेशन टेक्निक, सो वॉट इज द बेसिक एम ऑफ इमेज सेगमेंटेशन? यस, कॅन एनी वन टेल मी वॉट इज द इमेज सेगमेंटेशन? इमेज सेगमेंटेशन म्हणजे काय? Yes, anyone? What is the image segmentation? विसरलं का सगळं? ओके, सो इमेज सेगमेंटेशन मीन्स वी कॅन स्प्लिट द लार्जर इमेज इन टू द स्मॉल पार्ट्स. Right, so similarly, in order to find out the various centroids, we can split the original image into the small number of parts, so that is called as a wavelet. Okay, so if the image size is 1000 by 24 and 1000 by 24, and if we split the image into four equal parts, then whatever the small part of that image is referred as a wavelet. Okay, so by using this transform, we can split the image into the various sub parts, and each sub part is referred as a wavelet. Okay, so the basic advantage of this wavelet transform is that, so if we use the another transforms, so it might be limited to only one domain. Either
it may be limited to the spatial domain, or
either it can be limited to the frequency domain or time domain. But the basic advantage of this discrete wavelet is that, so it can used in a time domain as well as it can be used in a frequency domain. So in both domain, the discrete wavelet transform can be used. So we can divide the higher resolution image into the small subparts, right? So if we divide the higher image into the small subpart, then it is easy to identify the centroid of that particular image. Okay, so it is a basic aim of discrete wavelet transform. Okay, so in wavelet, there is a term that is called as a mother wavelet. Now, it is a mother wavelet. So if there is a large size image, so as we take an example, so image is a 1000 by 24 into 1000 by 24, and if we split that image into the four part, okay, so whatever this small part is called as a child wavelet. Now it is a origin image which having a origin size, it is a 1024 by 1024, it is called as a mother wavelet. And if we divide that mother wavelet image into the small parts, it might be referred as a wavelet or child wavelet. Okay, so here it is a mathematical representation of mother wavelet. So by using this, we can represent the discrete wavelet transform. Okay, have you understood it? Why we can use a wavelet transform? So the basic idea of the wavelet transform is that, so it can subdivide the image into the smaller part. Okay, so it is similar to the image segmentation. Okay, so by using this wavelet transform, we can divide the higher resolution image into the small part. Okay, so as we divide the higher resolution image into the small part, then it is easy to identify the centroids, various contents, various information from the images. Okay, so have you clear this, the concept of these four transforms? Yes. Okay, so the basic idea of the second unit is that we have to study these four transform and what is the mathematical representation of these four transform and where these four transforms can be used. So the first transform is a discrete Fourier transform, second one is a discrete cosine transform, third one is a KL transform, and fourth one is a discrete wavelet transform. Okay. Yes, any doubt? Yes, so have you understood the basic concept of these four transforms? Okay, so when we study the practical things, how we can represent the transform, how we can change the image from one domain into the another domain. Okay, so that time our concept should be more clear. Okay, so up to this, we have to study the representation of these four wavelets, sorry, representation of these four transforms, and what is the basic applications and advantages of these four transforms. So how we can use the transform in a particular applications. So if I have to reduce the size of image, so we can use the discrete cosine transform. So as we use the discrete Fourier transform, so it also compress the image, but it can require more memory size to store that particular image. So we have to reduce the storage capacity. So for that purpose, we can use the discrete cosine transform. Okay, clear?
Yes, any doubt? Okay, so the next part is the comparison between these two transforms. Okay, so so it is a comparison between DFT and DCT. It is a comparison between different types of wavelets. Okay. Okay, so this part will be covered in the next lecture. So if we also gone through this point, you can also get the idea how we can how we can make a difference between DFT and wavelets. So for what purpose DFT can be used, and for what purpose the wavelets can be used. Okay. Okay. So anyone have any doubts? Okay, so our second unit consists of only these four transforms. Okay, so out of these four transforms, any one transform can be used in a university exam. So in that case, we have to just study how we can represent it in a mathematical way. What are its advantages? What are its disadvantages? And what are its applications? Okay, so that 3 points we have to keep in mind. In a these four transforms. Okay, so today we'll stop here. So if you have any difficulty, then you can ask here. Okay, samajhne ka hai sir. Okay, so might be the second unit is difficult for understanding as compared to our first unit. Okay. Okay. So don't put random numbers. Sudarshan Koli, Upendra, number put kara sangilet ka? Imran Sheikh. Ani eka veles ekdas number put karayacha. Sudarshan Koli. किती वेळा नंबर पुट केलेत? 1 2 3 तीन वेळा आठवणच पाहिजे का? ठीक आहे, जरा नंबर सिक्वेन्स न पुट करा. सो स्टार्ट विथ रोल नंबर 1. हा गौरव गुरुजी, सुशांत हलदार, इफ युअर नंबर इज नॉट इन सिक्वेन्स आय नॉट मार्क युअर अटेंडन्स. सो वन्स अगेन स्टार्ट विथ रोल नंबर 1. येस रोल नंबर 1, वन्स अगेन वी कॅन पुट युअर नंबर. ओके, येस 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 absent 9. Okay, 10 11 12 12 put in a sequence. 12 is not there. 13 14 15 16 17 17 is not there. Okay, 17 is there. 18 19 20 21 22. Okay, 23 23. Okay, 24 25 26 27 28 okay, 29 30 31 32 33 34 35 35. Amit Dhanur is there. 36.
Sir, present sir.
Put your number after 34 35. Yes, put your number in chat box. Okay, 36. Okay, put your number in sequence. Okay, so in afternoon lecture, so at 12:30 at the time of ESD lecture,
अरे 35 नंतर 49 सगळा डायरेक्ट संजय पवार आफ्टर 35
असं कोण टाकतच नाही नंबर.
जर नंबर नसतील तर डायरेक्ट 35 नंतर 49 प्रेझेंट लागेल.
अहो सर
अरे जरा
36
नाही पटापट
1 to 39 नंबर सिक्वेन्स मध्ये येत आहे. 35 पासूनच का असं होतंय.
36 ने टाकलं नाही.
ठीक आहे बरं ठीक आहे. 12:30 ला ESD लेक्चर आहे तर ESD लेक्चर ऐवजी IPC लेक्चर होईल तिथं IVP. सो ऍट दॅट टाइम वी टेक अ टेस्ट ऑन युनिट नंबर 1. ठीक आहे टेस्ट ऑब्जेक्टिव्ह टाइप असेल. सो 20 क्वेश्चन्स विल बी देअर. ठीक आहे हॅलो.
ओके सर.
हां ठीक आहे. तर गुगल मीटच्या लिंकच्या ऐवजी मी तुम्हाला गुगल फॉर्मची लिंक सेंड करेल. तर गुगल मीटवर जॉईन होऊ नका. सो टेस्ट टाइम इज 1 hour. ठीक आहे 20 मार्काचे ऑब्जेक्टिव्ह क्वेश्चन्स असतील. सो इन्स्टेड ऑफ गुगल फॉर्म सॉरी इन्स्टेड ऑफ गुगल मीट आय विल शेअर द लिंक ऑफ गुगल फॉर्म. सो ऑन दॅट फॉर्म यू कॅन सबमिट युअर टेस्ट. ओके सो एव्हरी वन सबमिटेड. सो बेस्ड ऑन दॅट आय मार्क द attendance of 12:30 lecture. Is it okay?
Okay sir.
Okay so you can leave now.